Blackstone presents The Birth of the West, Rome, Germany, France, and the Creation of Europe in the 10th Century by Paul Collins. This book is read by Grover Gardner. Dedication. From Marilyn, with love and thanks for spending almost as much time in the 10th century as I did. Prologue. From the Fury of the Northmen, Lord, deliver us. The monk must have been studying very late that night, struggling to read by the flickering light of a couple of candles. The text of Priscian of Caesarea's monumental Institutiones Grammaticae, Principles of Grammar, was in Latin but written in Irish script. Even at the best of times, reading a manuscript on Greek and Latin grammar would have been hard labor. But our monk was working late, eventually making some 9,400 interlinear and marginal comments on this 249-page work, 3,478 of his comments in Old Irish. He was most probably reading Priscian at Bangor Monastery on the northeast coast of Ireland just after the year 850. Once the manuscript had been copied between 845 and 850 in the monastery's scriptorium or copying room, it made its way into the monk's hands, where he inscribed the thousands of glosses in Old Irish. Somehow or other, it later ended up at St. Gallen, Switzerland, where it is now a treasure in the Stiftsbibliothek, monastic library. The monk's glosses were intended to aid readers in getting a sense of the text. To today's scholars, they have become an important reference point for understanding the development of the Irish language. But they also tell us about the monk himself. Like many 9th-century Irish monks, he loved nature. He tells us so in a gloss about spending time reading the manuscript while sitting under a greenwood tree listening to a cuckoo as it flitted from bush to bush. On this particular cold midwinter night, our monk heard something else, the howl of wind and a storm whipping up the sea and the surf crashing on a beach nearby. But rather than frightening him, this tempest gave him a sense of security. It meant that for now at least, Bangor Monastery was safe from Vikings, who would certainly not be at sea on such a stormy night. In typical Irish fashion, he confided his sense of relief to the margin of the Priscian manuscript. The bitter wind is high tonight. It lifts the white locks of the sea. In such wild winter storm, no fright of savage Viking troubles me. For 75 years, Irish coastal monasteries like Bangor had been raided by the Vikings, and our monk was writing just at the time when these raids were escalating in frequency, violence, and intensity. Monasteries were attractive targets for the warlike pagan Vikings, who despised the monks, saw their assets, especially their often precious church plate, as booty, and identified them and their neighbors as potential slaves. The raid on Bangor was just one incident in a more than 200-year history that began in 775 with the burning of the holy shrine of the great missionary monk Columcella, Columba in Latin, on the island of Iona off southwestern Scotland. 86 monks were butchered on the beach in another raid in 806. Our monk probably actually knew some of the community who in 825 were killed by Northmen seeking treasure and attempting to destroy the relics of Columcella. From the Fury of the Northmen, Lord deliver us, was a frequent prayer, and it was always uttered with sincerity. People felt very vulnerable. Attacking suddenly and without provocation, the Vikings brought terror wherever they went. Ingvar, or Ivar the Boneless, was one such Viking, and he waged a private war against England during our monk's lifetime. We don't know why Ingvar was called Boneless. Suggestions have ranged from unusual physical flexibility to impotence in the sense that he could not get an erection to osteogenesis imperfecta, brittle bone disease, Some theorize that he was unable to walk and was carried about by four men on a shield. In any case, although born in Denmark, he learned the basics of being a Viking fighter as a young man in Ireland. Ingvar led his great heathen army to commit wanton cruelty and violence. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle says that early in Ingvar's invasion of England, St. Edmund the King of East Anglia fought against them, and the Danes won the victory at Hoxen in November 869, and they slew the king and overran the entire kingdom and destroyed all the monasteries to which they came. Captured in the battle, Edmund refused to cooperate with the Danes. There are various accounts of his death, all of them horrible. Adam of Bremen says that Ingvar the Boneless was the most cruel Viking of them all. According to Abbo of Fleury's account from a century later, Ingvar bound Edmund and insulted him ignominiously and beat him with rods. He then tied the king to a tree and beat him with whips, and then shot spears at him as if it was a game until he was entirely covered with their missiles like the bristles of a hedgehog. When Ingvar realized the king would not deny Christ, he had Edmund beheaded. His head was hidden in the woods, but people later found it protected between the paws of a large gray wolf. In another story, Edmund was sacrificed to the Scandinavian god Odin by having his lungs ripped out of his rib cage and hung around his neck. It was precisely this kind of violence that terrified people. It also justified the epithet "most cruel" that Ingvar took with him to his grave. Mind you, if our monk was honest with himself, there was really nothing new about these kinds of violent raids on monasteries. His fellow Irishmen did it all the time. But as foreigners and aliens, it was the Vikings who most terrified people. And so, as he studied Priscian, our monk thanked the bitter storms for protecting his monastery for another night. The early 10th century dawned in violence and disorder. All effective government had broken down. People lived in fear and chaos. Vikings launched raids with impunity. Saracen Muslim pirates terrorized the Italian coastline seeking slaves. The Magyars, Hungarians, terrorized much of Germany and over the Alps into Italy. And the breakdown of central government meant that ordinary people across Western Europe, but particularly in France, often lived in terror of local nobles who were really just thugs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.